of you are finished with your... Okay, I'll give you guys a couple more minutes. So, can somebody tell me what this story was kind of about?
The narrator killed his house guest and tried to hide it from the police, and ultimately, I guess, mental state, gave himself up.
Mm-hmm. He kind of tries to, justify what he does too. And, you see how Poe is pretty grotesque in his writing. There's another story he wrote called The Pit and the Pendulum. And basically, there's just a big pendulum, and it keeps going further and further, and it's just kind of like that guy thinking about different, about death, basically. But which of the, while you're reading, connectors did you do for this story?
I just kind of noticed while doing it, after he killed the man, he's like, if you still think me mad, you will think so no longer when I describe the wise precautions I took for the concealment of the body.
Right.
And that sentence is a mess.
Right.
In a nutshell. It's like, you might think I'm mad, but I was smart enough to hide it. And it's like, no, you're still mad.
Right. That's a good point. What about you?
A question I had was, why would the narrator choose to watch the old man at night if he was looking for the vulture eye? Because if you're asleep, your eyes are going to be closed.
Right.
So that was just something that kind of tied back into his insanity. Like, if he watches him every single night, his eyes are always going to be closed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's another thing to think about. How that dark romanticism is about, like, that sanity versus insanity and madness and different things, but that's a good example of that, too. Again, don't forget to do either this one or this for the next story, but I'm kind of going to have a change of pace, so we're going to read it, or we're going to listen to someone read it.
Volume of forgotten lore.
of someone gently rapping, rapping at my chamber door. To some visitor, I muttered, tapping at my chamber door. Only this, and nothing more. Ah, distinctly I remember it was in the bleak December, and each separate dying ember wrought its ghost upon the floor. Eagerly I wished tomorrow. Vainly I had sought to borrow from my books surcease of sorrow, sorrow for the lost Lenore, for the rare and radiant maiden whom the angels named Lenore, nameless here or evermore. And the silken, sad, uncertain rustling of each purple curtain thrilled me, filled me with fantastic terrors never felt before. So now, to still the beating of my heart, I stood repeating, to some visitor entreating entrance at my chamber door, some late visitor entreating entrance at my chamber door, this it is, and nothing more. Presently, my soul grew stronger. Hesitating then no longer, sir, said I, or madam, truly your forgiveness I implore. The fact is I was there, and so gently you came rapping, and so faintly you came tapping at my chamber door, that I scarce was sure I heard you. Here, I opened wide the door. The chamber turning, all my soul within me burning. Soon again I heard a tapping, somewhat louder than before. Surely, said I, surely that is something at my window lattice. Let me see then what that is, and this mystery explore. Let my heart be still a moment, and this mystery explore. This the wind, and nothing more. Open here, I flung the shutter. When, many a flirt and flutter, in there stepped the stately raven of the saintly days of yore. Not the least obeisance made he, not a minute stopped or stayed he, but with mien, lord or lady, perched above my chamber door, perched upon a bust of Paris, just above my chamber door, perched and sat, and nothing more. Then this ebony bird beguiling my sad fancy, smiling by the grave and stern decorum of the countenance it wore. Though thy crest be shorn and shaven, thou, I said, art sure no craven, ghastly grim and ancient raven, wandering from the nightly shore. Tell me what thy lordly name is on the night's plutonian shore. Quoth the raven, nevermore. Much I marvel this ungainly fowl to hear discourse so plainly, though its answer little meaning, little relevancy more. We cannot have agreed that no living human being ever yet was blessed with seeing bird above his chamber door. Bird or beast above the sculptured bust above his chamber door with such name as Nevermore. But the raven, sitting lonely on the placid bust, spoke only that one word, as if his soul in that one word he did outpour. Nothing further then he uttered, not a feather then he fluttered, still I scarcely more than muttered. Other friends have flown before. On morrow will he leave me, as my hopes have flown before. And the bird said, nevermore. Startled at the stillness broken by reply, so aptly spoken. Doubtless, said I, what it utters is it only stock and store, caught from some unhappy master, whom unmerciful disaster followed fast, and followed faster, till his song's one burden bore. Dirges of his hope, that melancholy burden more of never, never more. But the raven, still beguiling all my sad soul into smiling, straight I wheeled a cushioned seat in front of bird and bust and door. Then upon the velvet sea, I betook myself to thinking fancy unto fancy, thinking what this ominous bird of yore, what this grim, ungainly, gaunt, and ominous bird of yore meant in croaking, nevermore. This I sat engaged in kissing, but no syllable expressing to the fowl, whose fiery eyes now burned into my bosom's core. This and more I sat divining, with my head at ease reclining, on the cushion's velvet violet lining that the lamplight floated o'er. But whose velvet violet lining would the lamplight floating o'er? She shall press. Then, methought, the air grew denser, perfumed from an unseen censer swung by seraphim, whose footfalls tinkled on the tufted floor. Wretch, I cried, thy God hath left thee. By these angels he has sent thee respite and nepenthe from thy memories of it all. Quaff, O quaff this kind nepenthe, and forget this lust the more. Quoth the raven, nevermore. Prophet, said I, thing of ill. Prophet still, if bird or devil, whether tempter sent, or whether tempest tossed thee here, sure, desolate, yet all undaunted, on this desert land enchanted, on this home by horror haunted, tell me truly, I implore, is there balm in Gilead? Tell me, I implore. Quoth the raven, nevermore. Prophet, said I, thing of evil, prophet still, if bird or devil, by that heaven that bends above us, by that God we both adore, tell this soul with sorrow laden, if within the distant Aden it shall clasp a sainted maiden whom the angels named Lenore. Clasp a rare and radiant maiden whom the angels named Lenore. Quoth the raven, nevermore. Be that word our sign of parting, bird or fiend. I shrieked, upstarting, get thee back into the tempest and the night's plutonian shore. Leave no black plume as a token of that lie thy soul hath spoken. Leave my loneliness unbroken, quit the past above my door. Take thy beak from out my heart, and take thy form from off my door. Quoth the raven, nevermore. And the raven, never flitting, still is sitting on the pallid bust of Pallas, just above my chamber door. And his eyes have all the seeming of a demon's that is dreaming, and the lamplight o'er him is streaming through his shadow on the floor. And my soul, from out that shadow that lies floating on the floor, shall be lifted nevermore.
What did you guys think of that story? Like, can anyone summarize that a little bit? What was happening there?
He's like, I don't know if he was like having a hallucination because talking birds don't really exist.
Right.
Mm-hmm. He was trying to find a way to vent his feelings. I get like, I mean, the raven basically told him everything he didn't want to hear.
Mm-hmm.
So, like the manifestation of fears, I guess.
Mm-hmm. How do you think this story is a dark romantic story? Like, what aspects of dark romanticism is it in this story?